Good morning. Thank you, Brevin. Good morning, everybody, or good afternoon for you. Can we switch the controls? Ray, can you give me control? Of
yeah, if you click on the slide deck, you should find you have control.
I click.
Okay. You have control.
Yes, that is. Okay, good. Thanks. Oops. That's cool. Okay. What's conjoint analysis? Conjoint analysis is quite an old technique. It developed in the late 60s, early 70s of the last century by psychometrics, and in parallel, the economists developed a utility value theory. And in these days, the academics were interested in understanding how people do really make decisions, because by just asking what we do in market research, you see that people answer what interviewers want to hear, and you see the results are always on a scale, a rating scale, in between 5.1 and 5.6, so it didn't discriminate, and they answer what's top of mind. So the answers didn't really reflect what they actually would do, choose or buy. So it was clear. Choices involve a trade-off, and we have to capture this trade-off. Okay, let's look at a stylized example of a conjoint analysis. You have a choice. You have a choice between a bottle of Heineken and a bottle of Carlsberg. And because I was born and raised in Holland, I grow up with Heineken, so I will choose Heineken. And while choosing Heineken, you see that... that's something going wrong. Okay. While choosing Heineken, this is going wrong. So after a conjoint, you get a stylish example of the results. In this case, in the first choice, I did choose Heineken over Carlsberg. Then the price of Carlsberg was reduced to €1, and I did choose the Carlsberg product because it was €1 cheaper. By choosing, as a researcher, we can analyze the choices people make, and we can identify what value they attribute to the different drivers of choice. So I prefer Heineken over of Carlsberg, but I'm Dutch, so I didn't want to pay more than €1 for this. Okay, this is still an example. Good. When to use conjoint? Conjoint is a technique to measure what people prefer. By controlling the choice task, by observing what people choose, and by analyzing what they did choose, we can analyze what's driving their choices. The power of conjoint lies in capturing what really drives people in choosing products and services. The basic idea of conjoint analysis is that we mimic the actual choice process in research. Respondents will be shown choice tasks, they will choose, and by choosing they reveal their actual choice behavior. And with this information we can determine the importance of the driver of choice. And we can analyze the choice behavior of individuals. So there are three steps: collecting trade-offs, estimating buyer value, and making choice predictions. And these three steps form the basic of conjoint analysis. Let's think about conjoint and about attributes. In conjoint analysis, we assume that products are a combination of features. And what we do is we identify the value of each feature, and by doing so, we are capable of identifying the value of each product. Let's take a mobile phone. So you have different characteristics. You have design, brand, screen type, G3, GPRS, ringtones, etc., etc. It's important that all features are included in the study. When thinking about attributes and features, you have to realize that they should be actionable. And all actionable attributes should be included in the survey. Apart from that, it should cover all the decision drivers. Yeah? So, up front thinking and coin joint is extremely important. When thinking about attributes, you have to realize that attributes should be independent of each other. Because if you define attributes which are dependent of each other, you cannot create real choice size, or you create difficulties analyzing which attribute is a leading choice. Attribute and the attribute levels should span the whole range or the relevant range and somewhat beyond, because you use CoinJoin to predict the future. So prices might go up, and then you have to include higher prices. And last but not least, attribute should be not defined in marketeer's terminology, but should be defined in consumer language or benefits. Some other important questions about attributes are, how many attributes are appropriate? Now, as many as needed, but sometimes when you have a lot of attributes, it's not feasible. But from a marketing perspective, as many attributes as you need are appropriate. But when you do more than 20 or 30 attributes, all the value of each attribute will be more or less leveling out, and they will be all the same. So too many attributes leads to less precise insights. Do we have to use visual attributes, sensory attributes, age? Yes, because we have to mimic reality, so we have to show the products and the attributes as realistic as possible. And should we prohibit pairing of attributes? Yes and no. Yes, because we have to mimic reality. So it's not allowed that we combine attributes which are not acceptable in reality. The downside of prohibiting attributes to combine is that you impact the value estimation or the utility estimation of the attributes. Each attribute level has, after the choice task, each attribute level has a certain value for each respondent. What we do in CoinJoint analysis, we try to estimate the value by looking how often an attribute has been chosen and how often it has been shown. So by analyzing the choice people make, we estimate the value of each feature. And later on, we assume that the features are additive, so the sum of the feature value is the product value. Let's take an example. As you can see, this presentation is a little bit older than nowadays, because you see that in this study, Nokia for this client had a value of plus 20, Samsung of minus 15, and Siemens of minus 5. So after all these choices, this is the value we estimated for this specific individual. And games doesn't have values. No game doesn't have value, negative. The more games, the better. And of course, the lower the price, the better. So let's see what this person will choose. If we look at his utility of the different products, you can see that a Nokia with three games, which cost you 200 euros, has a value of 80. And Siemens with six games and 100 euros has a value of 32. And the Samsung with no games and €100 has a value of 5. So we assume that this person will choose the Siemens. Utilities are the key output of CoinJoint analysis. They represent the added value of the different attribute levels for the individual. So we can simulate. We can add, for instance in this case, a game and see how it impacts the choice. And apart from that, we can see which attributes are most important or impacting choices most. Be aware that utilities are the raw material and not the answers to the business question. Utilities, as I told you, are the raw material and are used in a model to simulate market scenarios. Because we know for each individual his value profile, the value of their features, we can play around with these attributes, and we can estimate what impact it will have when we change the product. For every market situation that we can define every market situation, and we can forecast the choices every respondent will make. Having the answers of the choices people will make will result in a share of choice or a share of preference for the individual and for the market. So we can simulate markets. That's why we do conjoint. Yeah, so utility enables us to simulate behavior, and combining the behavior of hundreds of individuals and hundreds of different situations, we can forecast all kinds of scenarios for the future. So we talked about attribute levels, utilities, etc. That's all the ingredients of what we do. So the key is now to cook a delicious meal. And to cook a delicious meal, we always have to start with the business problem. People often ask, do me a coin joint? That's useless. Really, what we have to ask is, what is the business problem we have to solve? So we translate a business problem in a research question, and then we start thinking and brainstorming about simulations. So before designing a coin joint, you have to define, what do I want to simulate? What answers do I want to have after the survey? With that questions, you interact and say, okay, that means that I have to include these attributes and these levels. And then you go into the standard market research process, so data collection, simulation, and you analyze all the simulations. That's what you analyze, not the utilities. What do you have to do in advance? In advance, you really have to define what is the answer and the results you expect, and also why do you expect it. That's what you have to do in conjoint analysis. So, setting up a conjoint analysis, you have to define the attributes, you have to define the target groups, you have to define the attribute levels, and last but not least, you have to define the context or the environment in which people make choices. Because people are choice sensitive and context sensitive, so in a different context, people make different choices. So thinking in advance, which attributes, how many attributes, how do I define the attributes, and in what context do you want to measure? Okay, now we go. There are different flavors of conjoint. The traditional way of conjoint analysis was more or less preference model where people ranked and rated alternatives. There are many traditional conjoint systems. From the old days, the ACA became this golden standard. After the preference models and the 20 years ago, I think, discrete choice models were introduced, or choice-based conjoint. And nowadays, it's more menu-based conjoint or adaptive choice. Based conjoint. Let's go into the three different flavors of conjoint analysis. First, ACA. ACA, the traditional way of conjoint, is extremely effective if you want to know what is driving people. It is not good to forecast of pricing research, but it's good when you have high involvement products and you're focusing on which feature might be of interest for the future. The term adaptive in adaptive conjoint refers to the fact that during the interview, the choices are tuned to the preference earlier given or identified in the interview. So the answers provided by individuals are input for the subsequent questions. Let's take an example. You can buy a desktop or a laptop, and you have the option of 3 GHz or 4 GHz. So you specify what you prefer, left, a laptop with a lower gigahertz or a desktop with a higher gigahertz. That's typical in conjoint analysis. So here, what you do, the combination you create is the combination which has more or less the same utility based on the earlier preferences. That's okay. The drawback of adaptive conjoint analysis is that it's a partial profile. You always combine a few attributes, but not a real-world presentation, and people doesn't choose. They can't say no. And in the past, the downside is that a computer is necessary. Nowadays, that's kind of standard. and it's absolutely not appropriate for pricing research. Another drawback, it uses main effects only, so you cannot analyze interaction between different features, and in reality that these interactions are extremely important. And the interviews are long and can be taxing, but the advantage is you get individual utilities. The newer kit on the blocks, arriving 20 years ago, was choice-based conjoint. Choice-based conjoint is a technique where you choose a product among a lot of other products. Yeah? And it's the technique really to define the optimal product design or portfolio in the market. And when you want to launch a new product, you can optimize the package, the pack size, the flavor, and the price. Pricing, CBC is often used for pricing research. Yeah. Okay, and then respondents have to choose from different products offerings. Here you see it still as single products, yeah, a bottle, and you specify the details. But nowadays, more standard is to send people on a shopping trip, and they are faced in front of a shelf, and from the shelf they can choose. In CBC, we define the attribute, but in reality, the choices are much more intuitive. So you have some promotions, you have prices, etc., and people look at the screen and automatically go often to the price or the product or the promotion, which they are sensitive to. Think about CBC as sending people on shopping trips. The strengths of CBC and discrete choice modeling is that choice tasks closely mimic what buyers do in the real world. They choose from available product. It's very good for pricing and forecasting, and you investigate interaction effects. Another strength is that you can include and should include the non-options. So, sorry, of these products I don't want to buy any. I don't like them. I stick to my current provider, so the non-option should be defined in a way that's realistic. Yeah? CBC also has some drawbacks. If you do a textable, you cannot include more than 6 attributes. Technically it's possible, but from a consumer perspective, it's very hard to digest more than 6 attributes in a choice task. But you can go higher, technically. Because people only say what they choose, you have a very low information ratio gained by a choice task. Consequently, we need more choice tasks, and sample sizes needs to be larger than by the traditional conjoint solutions. And nowadays, we always use hierarchical Bayes to estimate utilities, but without hierarchical Bayes, you have to work with aggregate utilities reflecting the average of the market, and that's not what we want. So what's the difference between rating and choice? They look similar, but they are not. Rating is more to identify the value of individual features for specific products, but you can't use it for forecasting. So different conjoint models, they look the same, but they are not. Then the last kit on the block is menu-based conjoint. What is menu-based conjoint? In menu-based conjoint, people can combine single features. There are many choice situations in real life where people don't choose intuitively, but they choose by really combining and adding features. When you buy a car, you can add a package. When you buy a telephone package, you can add television, you can add internet, etc. So there is more rational choice behavior. For that type of situations, menu-based conjoint or adaptive conjoint is the solution. Let's see a standard choice task. Assume you're entering a restaurant, Burger King in this case. So what you can do, you can buy a Whopper, but you can add extra salad. You can add fries. You want to have crispy onions, possible, but you can also take products away. So you can optimize your own choice, and that's what you do normally in a restaurant. And it's also what you do when you buy a computer online. More or less, you build your own computer. So why then not build your own computer in the choice situation? By mimicking reality, we can estimate the utilities for these products. Applications are mainly found by combining items methods. So the fast food restaurants, but also the telecom. Bundling is key. Also computers or optimal features pricing in the automotive market. And more in the financial markets and on services. In these type of markets, traditional CBC, which mimics more holistic choice behavior, is less qualified, and that's why nowadays menu-based or adaptive choice-based conjoint is developed and is in development. So that's for today. I really am ready to answer your questions, and I heard that you can also ask your questions on LinkedIn, so please ask them now or send them to LinkedIn.